Productivity 3000 gives you 7 communications ports right out of the box, and they all come standard. They're not something you have to purchase as an extra add-on. Whether you're getting connected with a programming software, interfacing with a Seymour HMI, expanding to local or remote I/O bases, or even integrating GS drives, this CPU has you covered. But sometimes, even that's not enough. For example, suppose you have a barcode scanner at every decision point and an order fulfillment line that's routing customer orders to picking stations. And suppose all of those barcode scanners have RS-232 outputs. Wouldn't it be great if you could just add serial ports as you need them? The Productivity 3000 Serial Communications Module, or SCM, allows you to do just that. You can plug in up to 11 of these 4-port modules for up to 44 additional serial ports in a single system. And configuring the serial ports is easy. Step 1, connect to a Productivity 3000 and go to the hardware configuration. Hit the Read Configuration button to auto-discover all the new SCM cards. Now, if this button's dimmed out like this one is, then the controller is in run mode. So we'll flip that switch on the controller to stop mode. Now if we hit the button and acknowledge that our system is different from the default, and then double-click on the result, we see this base has a 550 processor, an input simulator, and a single SCM card. Step 2, double-click on the SCM to configure its ports. We'll use port 2 in this demo. Let's give it a name we understand. We're going to be reading some ASCII characters in this demo, so let's call this ASCII Reader Port 2. Normally, I would leave the protocol at Modbus, but for our demo, we're going to be reading ASCII characters, so we'll use the ASCII protocol so we can test it with a simple terminal program. We use no parity, 8 data bits, 1 stop bit, no handshaking. These are all just usual options you would expect on a serial port. Now back here on the Options tab, we can use these module status tags to keep an eye on things. So let's change these from the usual group base slot point format to something easier to read. We're going to be reading ASCII characters in, so let's call this ASCII port 2 heartbeat timeout, buffer full, and port ready. We're not using the CTS, so we'll leave that alone. But let's change this to SCM2 ready. It tells us the serial control module is ready, which is handy if you do a hot swap of the module. Since we're not using the rest of these defaults, let's get rid of them so they don't clutter up our data view. These guys right here allow us to select if we want the system to halt when the card is removed, or allow us to do a hot swap without affecting the system. Let's enable hot swap. Well, that's it. We've set up the hardware and we configured the serial port. You would just repeat that for all the other ports that you want to use. Easy. And let's add the remaining tags to the data view. The red dot above the module reminds us that this module is configured for hot swap. Now you just use that port exactly like you would have used the CPU serial port. We're going to do an ASCII example in this video, so we'll use the ASCII IN instruction. Again, this is the exact same ASCII IN instruction that we've always had. The only difference is we choose the new serial port instead of the CPU serial port. Now, if you don't see your CPU serial port here, it's because you just haven't set it up for ASCII. So let's do it. For this example, we're going to send characters from a terminal program on a PC, so we want a random length string terminated by a carriage return. You would want to use a fixed length string if you're using something like a barcode that has a fixed number of characters. Do need to specify a max length, so I'll make that 80 characters. The ASCII code for return is 0D. I don't want any timeouts, no byte swapping, and we'll use the structure option for the tags, so we only have to type one name. Hit OK. Yes, we do want to define all these tags we just created, but let's make the max string length the same as the 80 character max we specified in the dialog. And now that we've created all those tags, let's go back into the instruction and add those to our data view. Finally, let's add a control bit so we can enable this instruction. Done. Let's transfer the project to the Productivity 3000 and see what happens. I'm using an open source terminal program called TerraTerm to send ASCII characters to the Productivity 3000 via a USB to serial converter cable. When I bring up that terminal program, I just tell it I want to do serial on the port that the converter is connected to. I want to set up the serial port on the PC to match the serial port we just set up on the Productivity 3000. Here's the dialog from the Productivity 3000, and we see that we need 192K baud, 8 bits, no parity, 1 stop it, and no flow control. Perfect. I'm going to tell the terminal to echo the characters so I can see what I'm typing, and make sure it sends a return at the end of each line, since that's what we told the ASCII IN instruction to expect. Here's our data view and terminal side by side. Let's add the control bit and use it to enable the ASCII IN instruction. We see the module's ready, the port's ready, but the ASCII IN instruction is not active. Why not? Well, we took the controller out of run mode back when we auto-detected the hardware, right? Flip that switch back to run, and sure enough, now the ASCII IN instruction is telling us it's running. Having all these tags to debug things is awesome. These guys down here are just a different way of displaying these guys right here. It's the same information. I prefer to delete these guys, so now everything I need to know about the ASCII IN instruction is collapsible under this. Let's also delete these MST bits that we aren't using. Great, let's try it. If we send characters from the PC, we should see them appear here in a destination string when we hit return. And sure enough, they do. Now, just for a moment, let's pretend that we have a fixed length string like the one that might come from a barcode scanner. To do that, we just modify the ASCII IN instruction to tell it to expect a fixed length string. We'll use 10 characters for this example, and transfer it to the controller. Let's clear the terminal screen, get rid of this garbage. Now if we type 10 characters, we should see them appear in the destination string when we hit that 10th character. And sure enough, we do. A few notes. We already said that you can have 11 of these serial control modules in a system. That's all 11 modules in a single 11-slot base, or spread out amongst remotes, too. It's all exactly the same. That gives you 44 additional serial ports to use anywhere in your system. Remember, the CPU has an RS-232 and an RS-45 port built in, so that's a total of 46 serial ports in a single system. Serial port 1 on the SCM supplies 5 volts on what would be the CTS pin, so now you can connect a Seymour Micro directly to the port without an additional power supply. And you can create another 422 or 45 port by connecting the fa-isocon. That gives you an extra 45 port with 1,000 volts of isolation. Ports 2, 3, and 4 do have the CTS pin for handshaking if you want it. All of these serial ports are full duplex ASCII ports that require no special configuration, and they support half duplex too. Port 4 can be used as an RS-232 or RS-45 port. And if you're using RS-45, you can add a termination resistor simply by jumpering T to plus right on the front panel terminal block. The LEDs on the front panel are great for debugging issues. You can see at a glance if there's activity on any of the lines. Keep in mind, these LEDs are connected directly to the wires. These are not under software control. So if you see an LED blink, that means that the wire's hot. Of course, this pin on port 1 is always on. That's that 5 volts that port 1 provides for the Seymour Micro. And it's also a good general purpose indicator, since it turns off when the 5 volt bus is overloaded. If you have any questions about the Productivity 3000 Serial Control Module, please don't hesitate to call Automation Direct's award-winning tech support during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help you out. Now, they don't support the terminal program I use, so don't call them about that, but do check out the forums. There are lots of folks there that love to share their years of experience. Performance plus value. That's productivity. From Automation Direct.com.